think it takes about 7 weeks, you know, with wheat and dairy. Mm. And if, I mean, if anybody out there is interested or thinks they have, you know, if they have asthma or eczema or canker sores or something, then I would say, yeah, you know, take yourself off dairy.
Mm. See what happens.
And see what happens, because if you get better, then... But then if you get better, then you have to acknowledge that, don't you? I mean, a lot of people don't want to get... They want to get better, but they don't want any change in their lifestyle.
Right. It's the way you describe it, it sounds a little bit like a friend of ours who stopped drinking in the evenings. It wasn't an alcoholic, but he stopped drinking in the evenings and realised almost straight away what it felt like to wake up in the morning without a slight hangover.
Sure.
That's terrific.
Sure.
Well, you can't name them now, I don't know. I can't.
A little rude to
have to think, I've got all my friends drunk.
All my friends have got hangovers.
Absolutely. So now what you've done a sort of a Paul Newman in the sense that you've marketed your own range of healthy foods. I mean, Paul Newman does his sauces and everything, and you do, well, what's his? Are these the ones?
Yeah, they're one of them.
Dark chocolates with the...
What's the name? Stamp? What do you call it?
Stamp collection.
Stamp collection. Yeah. I hadn't had... The thing is, I really like chocolate, but I haven't been able to have chocolate for 20 years.
Why? Because of the dairy?
Because of dairy and because of sugar, you know, cane sugar.
Yeah. So these are chocolate?
They were just sort of off limits to me.
So what's different about these chocolates?
Well, what's different about those chocolates is they don't have any dairy.
Oh, no.
They don't have any dairy and they don't have any cane sugar and they're organic, so they don't have any pesticide residues.
Mm. Right.
And I've been eating the sesame seeds all morning, and they are
awfully good. Yeah, they are good, actually. You need the strength of 10 men to get into them.
It makes it all the more enjoyable when you get them.
A bit of Zen there.
I'll get my teeth in there. Look, good luck with that. When did you launch that? How long has that been on the market for?
The stamp collection, we started with the vegetable chips about, 18 months ago. And these, this is the first week, really.
Dried apricot.
That's... organic apricot with the organic chocolate around.
Very nice. That's
quite
chocolatey.
Fine.
Okay, we'll go
now. Now we'll talk about the film.
Yeah, now we want to show some stuff here. I have to say, this clip we've got here, which you've seen God knows how many times, is it's possibly my favourite film clip from the 60s. Tell us about it.
The enemy, right?
No!
You're not scared, are you?
No.
Because if you're scared, it's tidy.
Chatting away, stress and whatnot.
A little chat.
Where was that shot, that scene?
Shot in Dorset, and it was an old Iron Age fort called Maiden Castle, which was where the ancient Britons made their last stand against the Romans.
Mm. Did you enjoy shooting Far From the Manning Ground? Was it a fun
time?
Yeah,
it was wonderful.
Yeah, it looked like you did, you can tell. Mm.
It was a wonderful time for all of us, and we sort of knew it, really. You know, the 60s, in fact, the swinging 60s, as they were called, so it really actually didn't begin until around 66.
That's true.
But in 66, we all had a sense that it was a very special time.
Mm. Things were unbuttoning.
Yeah.
Mm. It was a fabulous time for anyone who was young in those days.
Yes, I mean, to be young and in England in the 60s was...
Yeah.
Mind you, I heard the piece on Radio 4 today saying that American sociologists and commentators and the usual, pundits, are saying that London is now the coolest, officially, who decides these things, but that London is now the coolest capital and England, again, is the coolest country in the world. It's kind of come around again.
Yes.
Well, it does happen in other places,
No, I'm just saying what they're saying in America, swinging London, all that stuff, swinging England,
I thought it was all Manchester.
Please.
I think it's financial. I think it's like Ralph Lauren is buying up Bond Street and Donna Karan is buying up huge tracks. And in America, they're thinking, my God, if they're doing that, that must be happening there.
Mm.
What was interesting to me, I heard the other day, was clubbing. Mm. Was that all the French teenagers come over
they're
on Eurostar to go to the English clubs, which I like that idea of that.
They're going up to Sheffield, going to Manchester, Glasgow. It's extraordinary.
When you say that you all kind of knew it, you all had a sense, a feeling that it was going to be wonderful. Did you also have a sense that it couldn't last?
No. We thought that there was a sense of global awareness, really. It was mainly, it was initiated by the music.
Mm.
You know, there wasn't, I mean, people now talk about Oasis, but lots of people don't know about Oasis. But in the 60s, there wasn't anyone on the planet that didn't know about the Beatles, The music connected the world. It was suddenly, we had this global village mentality. And we thought that once that had been seen, we could never not see it.
Yes.
We could never not see that the world was one place, you know, to do with going to the moon.
Well, I was going to say that. I had, and going round ourselves would make the world a very different place, but of course it didn't.
Yeah.
But for people like you were very much, it wasn't just the 60s, I mean, you were very much part of the beautiful people. I mean, people like you, Mick Jagger, as you say, the Beatles, Julie Christie, Adam Faith, Michael Caine, all of whom you knew. And in fact, you used to go out with Jean Shrimpton, who was the face, wasn't it? Well, she and Twiggy. They were actually the main faces in terms of fashion and icons for girls then. And you must have been very aware of all that, that you were all stunning looking and that you all were, you were the sort of the trendsetters, if you like. The models for a generation.
You like her.
I like her.
Yeah. Well, it's true. I said the same thing to Marianne Faithfull, because Marianne Faithfull was sort of going out with Mick Jagger and everything, every single girl wanted to look like her. Yeah. And I should imagine every single man wanted to look like you.
Oh, she gets better and better.
It's supposed to be.
No, you wanted to look like Marianne Faithfull. I mean, who knows? The permutations are
Well, you almost did in Priscilla, Queen of the Desert, didn't you?
It's very hard for people to understand the 60s unless they had lived through the 50s, really.
Yeah.
Because the 50s was very bleak. It was life in black and white, you know. Mm. Everything. Mm. Everything was 50s. Mm. And we were sort of corseted, you know. And when I first started going out with girls, girls actually wore these things called roll-ons, you know. It was you could break your hand trying to, you know what I mean? It was kind of, there was like corsets, you know.
That's right, it gave rise to that, what was the schoolyard joke, boy meets girdle, do you remember that?
Yeah. So the 60s, you know, it was sort of after the pill but before AIDS, you know. It was this kind of explosion of colour and freedom and music and gaiety. And if you were in your 20s, at the beginning of the 60s, you really knew what was happening.
Yeah.
Because you'd lived through the 40s and the 50s. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So there was this incredible exhilaration, really. I mean, when the 60s started, I used to wake up smiling. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah.
And every day was some amazing new pop group, you know.
Yeah.
And you don't think, it seemed impossible that it could stop.
It's funny because my older brother is 10 years older than me, and he was the 50s and very bohemian and beatnik and all that kind of stuff. And actually, they used to get a bit annoyed with us because they thought their sort of university generation was serious about the world and serious about politics. And suddenly it came to the 60s and everybody got incredibly flippant and was talking about hippies and flower power and all the rest of it. And we just didn't take politics seriously. Did you feel that?
Well, we knew it didn't work. You know, we knew that politics had never worked. I mean, politics in the history of civilization, you know, politics had never transformed the individual. Mm. You know.
It's always been a muddle, hasn't it?
Always a muddle.
You know. Mind you, it was our generation that saw off the Vietnam War, really, wasn't it?
That was TV. It was TV that killed the Vietnam War.
Yeah.
I think in the 60s, the change in the 60s, you know, the philosophical change, was the fact that we kind of understood that it was our responsibility to change, or it was one's responsibility to change oneself.
Mm.
And that it was only by taking on your own ego, let's say, that the world was going to change. Mm. In other words, you know, instead of trying to fix everyone else, one put one's own house in order.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then there would be some kind of fundamental transformation.
Yeah. Mm.
And I think that was really the difference in the thinking.
Mm.
And what happened was that in the 70s, we just reverted to greed, really.
Mm. Mm. Mm.
We'd lost our nerve. I think we blew it, you know.
Mm.
But it was the golden section, you know, in my life, certainly.
We can't let you go without seeing Priscilla, Queen of the Desert, can we? Because it's such good fun.
I know you asked all your friends and advisors whether you should take this role, and you wanted them to say no. They said, go on, do it. And I'm glad you did. We've just got a little clip. Priscilla in the Desert.
I'm
That was great. Tremendously good fun. You look like you're enjoying it a lot.
I did.
When was that film? That was 2 years ago?
Year before last.
You enjoyed it?
I did, yeah. I think it was the most fun movie I ever made.
Some wonderful scenes in it. Well, we had to finish it.
I'm afraid. I'm getting told off by our PA. We're running so far over. It's lovely to meet you.
Okay.
Good to see you. Thanks a lot, John.
We'll nibble on your what's-its a lot more.
Stamp collection. In shops now.
Okay, we're taking another...